Good morning. Welcome to Lamb of God Church this morning. We're happy to have you all here. Would like to ask you to please silence your electronic devices before our service begins. We appreciate that very much. In your bulletin, you have a postcard that looks like this. It's from our preschool, and there's one in every bulletin, and it has a $100 coupon on the back. So if you know someone with children, a neighbor, a friend, if you happen to be in Publix and you see somebody with a child, if you wouldn't mind handing that off to someone that you know or meet, the preschool would really appreciate that, and that I'm sure the parent would appreciate that as well. Thank you. And next Sunday, we have our summer Q&A, our third session, and this topic is prayer. It'll be held in the Arbor Sanctuary with Pastor James. And at this point, no one has stumped James at one of these yet, but that offer is still ongoing. If you stump him with a question, then you win a prize. So we hope to see you all there next Sunday. And in a couple weeks, we have our end of summer celebration. Some of you were here for that last year. We had a 10-foot-long ice cream sundae that we'll be doing again. The youth group will be preparing that. And we'll have bingo, which will be lots of fun. Again this year, our grand prize is a night's stay at a hotel. And I believe this one is in Naples. So we hope that you'll join us. We'll be selling bingo tickets that day before and after church. And it's a great time to hang out with everyone and enjoy being here and say thanks for being here all summer, and it's great to have everybody back from vacation, so please join us that Sunday. And at this time, I'm gonna ask Pastor James to come forward and continue with the announcements. Thank you.
Thank you, Wendy. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to Lamb of God on this Feast of the Transfiguration. This is a feast we celebrate twice a year at Lamb of God, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in the sermon, but just to orient you to today, the reason why is because the Lutheran part of ourselves, we as Lutherans celebrate this feast the week before Lent to do something really big and happy before Lent. The Episcopal part of ourselves, together with Orthodox and Roman Catholics, celebrate this feast at or near August 6th, which is its sort of traditional date. So we do it twice a year here, and that's because it's really important, and I'll be talking about that. Right now, I want to talk with you about something else that's really important. Life, lead interfaith for empowerment. I talked about this a little bit last week, and you guys have been hearing about life, and our membership, lead interfaith for empowerment, is the way we as a local congregation concretely and directly and positively work with other congregations, other houses of worship in our local area, to better the lives of our least fortunate sisters and brothers. So if you want to know how can the gospel play out concretely in my life, this is how. And lucky for you, there is a meeting today after church with the magnificent Helen Sams. Helen, would you please raise your hand or stand? Welcome. We're glad you're with us, Helen. That meeting will be in the Arbor Sanctuary after this service. I want to give you an update. 35 of you filled out the Adult Spiritual Enrichment Survey. Do we have any of those saints of the church with us today? A couple of people. Good for you, because guess what? We're going to listen to what you said. Those of you who didn't fill it out, next year, right? These surveys matter. We do it so we can best serve you. I want to give you a quick result. 35 people filled it out. Four classes. Four ideas stood out at the top, and we're going to definitely do programs, workshops in all these four areas. Seeing Scripture with new eyes, which is using Scripture to look at the holiness of our own lives. Being at peace with ourselves and others. This is going to be a course that deals with nonviolence, politically, socially, in our relationships. Meditation. That's going to deal with meditation, right? We're going to learn different tools to meditate and enjoy doing that together. And the sacred in science and religion. We'll be doing some other fun stuff too, but these are the four that the congregation has selected, so we're definitely going to do these. So I always want to just report out on these kind of tools when we do them. Finally, I want to welcome our musicians. Thank you for being with us, folks. Our ensemble this morning is part of what will hopefully make this Transfiguration Sunday a wonderful day for all of us. Also want to welcome any first-time visitors. Is there anyone who's here for the first time or back from a long, long time? All right. Like it's an all in-house crowd today. That's just fine. Then please, let us stand, let us get our voices ready, and let us sing with joy our opening song. One that involves trust in God that lives in us. This morning, closing your eyes, coming into stillness, look into yourself and remember there, see there, some piece of your life that brings you pain. Maybe something you've done. It may be something that was done to you. It may simply be the way you think about things. And see that pain inside you. see it as darkness, without fear, face that darkness. And now see inside yourself the candle. The candle that might be in your heart or in your guts. And see that candle get lit. And see with your inner eye the light of that candle fill your body. See that the darkness cannot overcome the light. Feel that light as who you most deeply are. And in these next few breaths of silence, taste that light that the darkness cannot overcome, that light that shines from Christ and shines from each one of us. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord, today we remember the ever-present reality of the glory of divine light shining through human flesh, shining through all of creation. Help us always to see that light in ourselves, in one another, and in our world. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
A reading from the second book of Kings. Just before God took Elijah to heaven in a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on a walk out of Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here. God has sent me on an errand to Bethel." Elisha said, "Not on your life. I'm not letting you out of my sight." So they both went to Bethel. The guild of prophets at Bethel met Elisha and said, "Did you know that God is going to take your master away from you today?" "Yes," he said, "I know it, but keep it quiet." Then Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here. God has sent me on an errand to Jericho." Elisha said, "Not on your life. I'm not letting you out of my sight." So they both went to Jericho. The guild of prophets at Jericho came to Elisha and said, "Did you know that God is going to take your master away from you today?" "Yes," he said, "I know it, but keep it quiet." Then Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here. God has sent me on an errand to the Jordan." Elisha said, "Not on your life. I'm not letting you out of my sight." And so the two of them went on their way together. Meanwhile, 50 men from the guild of prophets gathered some distance away while the two of them stood at the Jordan. Elijah took his cloak, rolled it up, and hit the water with it. The river divided, and the two men walked through on dry land. When they reached the other side, Elijah said to Elisha, "What can I do for you before I'm taken away from you? Ask anything." Elisha said, "Your life repeated in my life. I want to be a holy man just like you." "That's a hard one," said Elijah. "But if you're watching when I'm taken from you, you'll get what you've asked for, but only if you're watching." And so it happened. They were walking along and talking. Suddenly a chariot and horses of fire came between them, and Elijah went up in a whirlwind to heaven. Elisha saw it and shouted, "My father, my father, you, the chariot and cavalry of Israel." When he could no longer see anything, he grabbed his robe and ripped it to pieces. Then he picked up Elijah's cloak that had fallen from him, returned to the shore of the Jordan, and stood there. He took Elijah's cloak, all that was left of Elijah, and hit the river with it, saying, "Now where is the God of Elijah? Where is he?" When he struck the water, the river divided, and Elisha walked through. The word of God, the word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Oh,
Holy Gospel according to St. Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make 3 dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice. "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. So they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what this rising from the dead could mean. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Lord.
Please be seated. So there's lots of different ways to read Scripture. And one of the ways I want to invite you into today, which can be very helpful in general, is to remember that in some way or another, every time we read a Scripture story, or even better, hear one together as a community and church, we're being taught about ourselves. There's some piece of the story that's a mirror that helps us figure out who we are. Now, this is never more apparent than today on the Feast of the Transfiguration. Because in the early church, you know, the Transfiguration wasn't understood as something unique to Jesus. It wasn't understood as showing us Jesus' divinity as something different than ourselves. It was understood as showing us Jesus' humanity. Showing us, each of us, who we really are. Here's a story about this. When I was in Miami, one of my friends was a woman who is in charge of contemplative outreach, which is a group of people who meditate together and try to get other people to meditate together with them. And she had this big meditation group in Miami, and contemplative outreach was a project from Thomas Keating, who's a monk, a very holy man, spent most of his life, or a lot of his life, sort of reinvigorating his meditation practice, a particular type of meditation and teaching. And she was at a retreat with Thomas Keating. And she said, "Oh boy, I'm going to get my 20 seconds with my guru, with my master. I got to come up with this great question to ask Thomas Keating." So she says she spends all weekend when she's supposed to be meditating, like thinking about what her question is going to be, right? So everyone's online, you know, to get their blessing from the master, Thomas Keating. And my friend gets up there and asks her question. And her question was this. She said, "Is it the sin of pride to want to be a saint?" And she said, Thomas Keating kind of looked at her and scratched his head and said to her, "Why stop there? Why not become God? Wow. What does this mean? Is Thomas Keating kind of a crazy old monk? Is he somebody that maybe meditated too long or hung out in the New Age section of the bookshop with, you know, too many titles?" No, what he's talking about is a deep thread that runs through our tradition, a deep thread that we can trace back to Scripture, where Paul says to us, "Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you?" A thread we could trace back to many of our mystical theologians, like Simeon the New Theologian, who isn't really that new, he's from like the 13th century, But he says this, he says, can the person who has in their heart the divine fire of the Holy Spirit burning naked not be set on fire, not shine and glitter, and not take on the radiance of the deity? Same golden thread. More recently, C.S. Lewis, great Christian writer, says this in his book, Mere Christianity. He says, the command, be ye perfect. You read that old translation of the Bible, right? The command, be ye perfect, is not idealistic gas, nor is it a command to do the impossible. God said in the Bible that we were gods, and he is going to make good his word. He will make the feeblest and filthiest of us into a god or goddess, dazzling, radiant, immortal creatures, pulsating all through with such energy and joy and wisdom and love as we cannot now imagine. A bright, stainless mirror which reflects back to him perfectly, though of course on a smaller scale, his own boundless power and delight and goodness. The process will be long and in parts very painful, but that is what we are in for. Nothing less. He meant what he said. So we celebrate this feast twice. We celebrate it twice because it's so easy to get confused as to what's going on here. Right? We may think the Transfiguration is about seeing Jesus' divinity. It's really about seeing our own humanity, who we are. If we want to see what divinity looks like, we look at the cross. How about that? This feast brings us back to our foundational story, creation. That's why this happened 6 days later, right? If you didn't pick that up, that's the gospel writer saying, hey, talking about the week of creation here. This is what it's all about. We're made in the image and likeness of God. Now, you're probably not the only person out there saying, what's this all about? This isn't what I was taught. Is this some kind of crazy stuff? No. Here's the thing. We have a problem, a cultural problem, with understanding this feast, I believe. And this problem means that we have a lot of history that we have to kick through. We're not going to do it all today, don't worry. But a lot of history to kick through to understand what this light that shines through Jesus means. For instance, this is a Western problem, for instance. Not a Christian problem. A Western culture problem. People who don't, who aren't Christians have this same problem I'm going to talk about. People who are Christians but not in the West don't have this problem. The problem is this. The problem is in our anthropology. What we think about the human being. Because a lot of us grow up thinking that there's something wrong with the human being, thinking that we are depraved and defiled and terrible. Why do we think that? I don't know. Certainly we do depraved and terrible things, but is that who we are? Is that our foundational reality? Why would we think something so bizarre as that? Maybe because a few hundred years ago, our ancestors in Europe, our spirits, wherever we come from, the Western Church, these folks are our ancestors. 1/3 to 2/3 of them got wiped out by the bubonic plague. And some people might think maybe we have this big 100-year, multi-100-year case of survivor syndrome. Maybe we're still dealing with the fact that we're here, they're not. Maybe it comes from taking St. Augustine to the extreme. St. Augustine was what in modern terms we might call a drama queen. All right, he was a little too worried about beating himself up. He was a little too into remorse. He was a little too into self-pity, perhaps. But then some people took what he said, and he was a genius, took what he said and really put jet engines on. One of those folks was Cornelius Jansen. Cornelius Jansen is a pleasant enough looking fellow, not really. Thought you'd enjoy that one. Cornelius Jansen, in his theology, focused on all the fun stuff in life. Sinfulness, guilt, remorse, what he called human depravity, and how what was good seems so far away from who we are and and our experience of reality. You remember Debbie Downer in Saturday Night Live? Womp, womp. But this is serious stuff, right? This goes against our foundational documents that tell us we're made in the image and likeness of God. And so Jansen was rightly condemned as a heretic. And yet, many Christian people think that Jansenism is what we think. They think as Christians we're supposed to be focused on sin and guilt and remorse, and we're supposed to be focused on the image and likeness of God. This heresy remains as some kind of chronic infection in our bloodstream. And we may never get rid of it, but we can at least know it for what it is. Why do we think this way? Maybe it's Jansen's fault. Maybe it's bubonic plague. Maybe it's a lot easier to think that we're totally depraved. Now that's an actual theological term. That's not me being a drama queen, right? Total depravity is how some theologians, Christian theologians, ended up describing the human being. And maybe in some ways it's easier to think that that's who we are, rather than really dare to believe, to dare to hope in the promise that is held out for us in what is truly our tradition, the promise that we are to be transformed into Christ for the world. Marianne Williamson, who's sometimes a pretty orthodox Christian writer, has this great quote that was quoted by Nelson Mandela. She says this, she says, "Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. We were born to make manifest the glory of God that is within us. It's not just in some of us, it's in all of us. And when we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others." So we are meant to become gods. We are meant to become goddesses. But there's a catch. The catch is this. The part of us that probably most wants that isn't the part that God wants to deify. Our egos, our personalities, our structures of repetitive, addictive, or compulsive behavior that's driven by fear, all those pieces of us that want the power, those aren't the pieces that are meant to get it. That's why, while Transfiguration shows us humanity, the cross, the emptiness, the surrender shows us divinity. So how do we know? How do we figure out that we're growing the right way? If we're about creating this light, how do we know that we're doing it in a way that makes us into Christ and not in a way that just sends our ego into dizzying flight? I think we get the answer in our readings today. At the end of that first reading, where Elisha takes on the mantle of Elijah and succeeds him in a lineage of great holy masters in the Hebrew tradition, he's told, he said, "You'll become a holy person if you watch, if you see what's happened." What does that mean? That means if you get out of your own stuff and look, you'll become holy. And then in our New Testament, in our gospel lesson, we hear the same thing. There's, you know, this great transfiguration. There's the white raiment. There's the voice. There's all this. And what does the voice say? It says, "Listen. Listen to him." We're meant to listen. What does listening look like? Well, I don't know. All I can do is tell you my own experience. You know, for me, when I'm trying hard to get what I want, and I feel that I'm in competition with other people, I'm typically not listening very well. When my ego self, when the part of me that's driven by self-preservation, when the part of me that's driven by fear gets in my driver's seat, I'm not listening very well. And when it seems that life is happening to me instead of for me, I'm not listening very well. But on the other hand, in those rare moments where I try to find out how the passions in my life align with the needs of the world, I start hearing things. I'm listening. When I try to find out how the Holy Spirit is speaking to me in events that I have little or no control over in my life, I'm listening. And I start hearing stuff. When I experience the world and everybody in it, as an invitation rather than a threat, I'm listening. Transfiguration, we kind of moved it a little bit. It happens on August 6th. August 6th is an important day because Jesus takes his disciples up on Mount Tabor, which is 2,000 feet high and overlooks a flat plain. It's seen by half of Galilee, and gives them this experience. So they would have, everyone there, the whole country would have seen this. So this is a personal experience for them, but it's not a private experience. It's a day where the light spread out over the world. August 6th is also the day that we dropped the atomic bomb on Hiroshima in Japan, 1945. The fallout from that light, from that bomb, likewise, was seen and spread throughout the world. One light shows us life, shows us the divine humanity that we are. The other light shows us death and shows us the bizarre and ignorant and twisted beings we can become. Which light do we bear into our world? Are we a bomb going off in people's lives? Or are we that gracious light of Christ? If we're honest, each of us is probably a bit of both, aren't we? How do we become more of the one and less of the other? Again, I think it has to do with listening. When we listen for that voice in prayer, when we listen for that voice in one another, when we listen for that voice in the needs of the world, we become less of the toxic bomb that Cornelius Jansen thought we were and more of the image and likeness of God that our tradition tells us we are. We see one another, friends and enemies, neighbors and strangers, shot through with the light of Christ. We see all creation that we use and enjoy and that we abuse and pollute, shot through with the light of Christ. And eventually, we even see ourselves. We even see ourselves shot through with that light of Christ. All we have to do is watch and listen. If we watch and listen, we wake up to a world that's shining like the sun and find that God's own life is lived right here in us.
Amen.
Good Lord, to be
community of faith, affirm our faith in that God who is the light of the world. We believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally God and the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being of the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate of the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified in the Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand.
Please be seated for the prayers of the people. O God of life and glory, on this Transfiguration Sunday, your Son was revealed in splendor before he suffered death upon the cross. Grant that we, beholding his majesty, may be strengthened to follow him and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory. Let us pray using the response, Holy God, hear our prayer. The Mighty One speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. We pray for the Church Universal and the Church gathered here in this sacred space. May professing Christ as Lord unite us all, reconciling us one to another. In hope we pray, Holy God, hear our prayer. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. We pray, O Lord, that you bless and strengthen all who serve your church, our presiding bishops, our own bishops, our pastor, James, and the staff and volunteers at Lamb of God who serve the church and the world and all the people of God. In hope we pray, Holy God, hear our prayer. Our God comes and does not keep silence. We pray for the leaders of all the nations. May they heed their advisors about the environmental effects of wasting the resources of this earth. And may concord, unity, and reconciliation be the watchwords of the coming generations. In hope we pray, Holy God, hear our prayer. He calls to the heavens above and to the earth that he may judge his people. We pray for all the victims of violence this day, whether the violence is physical, mental, or spiritual, that all who suffer from adverse weather or at the hands of another be lifted up and find safety and comfort in your loving arms, Father. In hope we pray, Holy God, hear our prayer. Gather to me my faithful ones who made a covenant with me by sacrifice. We pray for those we have placed on the Lamb of God prayer list: Kim Marie, Jean and Pete, Mary and Leroy, the family and friends of Robert Schumann, Jerry, Mary, Christopher, Penny, Hope, Zoe, Vicky, Miriam, Mary, Ruth, Tom, Eric, and for those we hold in our heart or now name aloud: Jimmy, Daddy. In hope we pray, Holy God, hear our prayer. The heavens declare his righteousness, for God himself is judge. Father, we thank you for this day, for your grace, and for one more experience of your presence, for your promise to be with us, to be our God, and to give us salvation. In hope we pray, Holy God, hear our prayer. Hear my words, O my people, and I will speak. I am God, your God. In your hands, O Lord, we humbly entrust our departed loved ones, especially Robert. In this life, you embraced them with your tender love. Bid them now eternal rest. The old order has passed away. Welcome them into paradise, where there will be no sorrow, no weeping, or pain, but fullness of peace and joy. In hope we pray, Holy God, hear our prayer.
Lord God, our Heavenly Father, our Heavenly Mother, we bring all our deep needs and sadnesses to you, knowing that it is through the cracks of our hearts that the light shines through. We bring to you our deep hopes and dreams and joys, knowing we already stand in that light. And all these prayers we make in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
My sisters and brothers, the peace of the Lord be always with you. Thus, given himself for us, offering a gift of God.
Thank you.
Today we talked about transfiguration. A big word, right? Does anybody know what transfiguration means? Anybody remember?
Form.
When you, thank you, yes. Whew. Yes, when you transform, right? And who was transforming in the Bible? Who did we talk about that was transforming in the Bible?
Jesus.
Jesus went up with some of his good buddies, sat on a mountain, and kind of waited around, right? And what did God do? Did you guys talk about this in middle school? What did God do? What did he do? He shined this light, right? It was like a spark hit in transformed Jesus, right? And he was kind of glowing, right? And he was transformed. Because was God able to come down here and kind of be with all of us? Kind of chill out and talk to us and... No, nobody's interested. Okay, it must be the end of the summer. All right, I'm gonna get you interested. I give up sometimes, right? So today I'm going to do an experiment, okay? Yes, come over here. So, this is what? Do you know what this is? It's a sparkler, right? And it's kind of, on the outside, it's kind of dull. It's kind of, what color is it? Gray. Kind of like us every day, right? We're kind of this ordinary people. But you all have to remember that inside of us, did you not practice this beforehand? Do you want to kiss me? Why would you name Pastor James? So this week, I want you to all kind of find peace with yourselves, find some quietness, and let God put that spark inside of you, right? It's already there, but you have to let it go. You have to release it and try something new, right? We talked about trying new things, and also how sometimes things don't, they aren't what they appear to be, right? Sometimes you will be so surprised when you try something or you reach out to a new friend. They can be people that you just never knew were meant to be in your life. So you need to be willing to transform and to change a little, and great things are going to happen, right? Like the sparkler. It looked kind of dull, but then when you lit it, you get all excited and there's a spark. Can you do that, Dylan? Yes. Okay, praying hands. I know I was excited to do this. I don't know. But praying hands. Praying hearts. Dear God, thank you for giving me a fabulous spark and the ability to transform and change and do amazing things for the whole world. And all God's children said,
as we continue our service this morning, my sisters and brothers, I remind you that this is God's table, and in God's eyes, all of us are filled with life. So any who feel welcome and invited are welcome and invited to receive this Holy Communion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who, sharing our life, lived among us to reveal your glory and love, that our darkness should give way to your own brilliant light. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name, and we join their unending hymn. Blessed are you for the birth of creation. Blessed are you in the darkness and in the light. Blessed are you for your promise to your people. Blessed are you in the prophets' hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. Blessed are you for your Son, Jesus, the Word made flesh. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is dying. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us and within us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming. Let the church cry out, "Come, Lord Jesus."
Come, Lord Jesus.
Holy God, we long for your Spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. Let the church cry out, "Come, Holy Spirit."
Come, Holy Spirit.
All praise and glory are yours, O Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, Power of the Most High, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now, as we prepare to be one by sharing in the bread and in the cup, let us form one body as we pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and
of God, for the people of God. Taste and see that the Lord is good.
Join in our communion hymn, we are called, let us break bread together.
Together on our knees.
Let us
Thank you.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.